Praise God. Hallelujah. All
Hallelujah.
right. We're talking about today, the teaching this morning is about God is still in charge. God is still in charge. Regardless of what is going on around the world, regardless of what is happening, regardless of what is going around you, God is still in charge. And you can also view the recording on the conference telephone dialing number. I'm recording to save the teachings today. So you can
conference recording started.
Always ask for that code when you want to listen to it. Amen. For you, you can always have access to it. We've made so many. We've made it available. We've made so many things available to you so that you can have access to our teachings. You can have access to what we're doing. We've made available to you so many stuff so that you can really benefit. You can really grow. Our goal is for spiritual growth and enlightenment, spiritual growth and establishment, that you become mature in Christ and you come into the fullness of everything that God has planned for you.
Amen.
That is the joy. That is the joy of ministry. That is the joy of ministry, that you come into that place, that you become so mature in the Lord. And you're able to bring results with your faith. Sometimes you look at things around you and you often question what is going on. You've been in that place where you're asking about situation and you're concerned about life, about reality, about what is happening around you, and you question yourself and say, is God really in charge of my life? Often people go through that phase and they begin to ask if there's a God, why is this not happening? Or if there's a God, this will not be happening. If there's a God, why am I having this problem? If there's a God, why is this and so going on with me? If there's a God, why did this happen to this person? Well, hopefully we can put a foreclosure to some of those questions you were asking. Do you know that ever since God created the earth has always rebelled against God? That is nothing new for God's integrity to be questioned by man. In fact, man seems to enjoy questioning the reality of God. I don't know why reason. You need to ask Adam and Eve, because they started a trend that has mushroomed to what we call today Christianity, in the sense that man can speak to God, man can challenge God, man can question God, and in fact, man can disobey God and get away with it. Has there been a time that God has lost the world, that God has lost the battle, that God has really become helpless, that God cannot function again because something is happening around the world and God has just lost it? Well, let me refresh your mind. You understand that Christianity has always been an exclusive calling. What I mean by that, it has been privileged people who have been called. God did not want to save the whole world in the days of the olden days. In fact, the Bible tells us that Adam and Eve sinned against God. They were the only two people in the earth when they sinned against God. And yet, you thought God lost, right? I mean, you concluded that, oh boy, he has no more friends anymore. Wow, the devil said to himself, boy, look at that. Didn't I tell him I'm going to take all his thing he's doing? And you thought God was, reproached. Oh, pity God. God, we have to pity you now. You don't have any friend, right? Adam and Eve, the only two men you made in the whole earth. But you must understand the way God operates, that God is content in himself.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You understand that God is content. The host of heaven are worshiping him. If it's for worship, God has too many worshippers already.
Who have not seen.
You know what I'm saying? Okay, you look at it. Let's rewind to pre-creation, before creation. It was only angels. And then Satan, sin entered, sin discovered devil itself. And the devil, sin was found in him. Now, God did not create sin. Just like God existed, Sin somehow, in the mystery of creation, just existed itself. Well, you cannot have two gods in the universe because sin is a god of his own. That's why the Bible says, whoever you submit to is your god. Sin itself is a god. Sin corrupted the devil. The Bible says, till iniquity was found in him. So it wasn't created with iniquity. It was found in him. Well, let's leave that. When we get to heaven, we ask the Lord how that thing came about. Yet we know from our Bible studies, from the word of God, that sin entered the world. And when sin entered the world, the universe, first of all, it contaminated the angels who were worshiping God for immortality. Because there's no calendar in heaven. There's no Monday, Tuesday. There's no 1 o'clock. There's no time. Time and space does not exist in heaven. In fact, this should be a comfort to all of you believing God for a miracle and you're counting. Well, God does not count. Sorry. God does not know arithmetic. Let me use that word. It's like, you know, it's a metaphor. God does not know arithmetic. Meaning God does not count your time. Does not move by her 24 hours. There's no way a man can condition God. You cannot condition God.
Hallelujah.
Your time and space, your time frame cannot condition God. Your time frame is limited to you. To a man like you, right?
That's right.
So you cannot condition God. You cannot tell God, well, you know, God, you have to walk on this timetable. If I don't hear from you by next week, 12 p.m., I won't serve you anymore. Well, congratulations. You can't give God a condition. You're a man. You are limited in time and space. You cannot be at one place at the same time. You cannot even in your own home. You cannot sleep in all the beds at the same time. If you have 4 cars, you can't drive all of them at the same time. If you have 5 suits, you can't wear all of them at the same time. And so you are limited. Therefore, you can't condition God in your own time and space. Because God can be everywhere in the same time. God can be in all your bedroom at the same time.
Hallelujah.
God can ride on all your cars at the same time. God can be in all over the earth and still be in the planets outside the earth at the same time. Your time and space is conditioned to earth. Once anything passes the earth realm to another planet, time and space do not exist in that realm. All right, so you find that the angels sinned against God. 1/3, Paul. Now you thought God have lost again, right? You should be pitying for him, right? Oh, God. It seems everybody just hit on you. They take from you. They just run away. What's going on, God? Someone say God is still in charge.
God is still in charge. Hallelujah.
Well, he got rid of the enemy. He got rid of devil and all the angels. He trashed them off heaven. They fell on the earth. Stars and the galaxies. Just trashed them. He haven't time to deal with it. I don't know what time went by and God created man. Another thing again, he just... For his own glory, for his own pleasure. Nobody forced him. Nobody said, hey, you need to create man now. You are missing worship. No, he just want to make fun. He want to see another side. He's so smart. He's a wise God. The Bible says he's the only wise God.
Yes,
he is a very intelligent and a very smart being.
Yes, he is.
He has all the wisdom in the world. For his own pleasure. He says, where with all things were created for his own pleasure. So he's worthy to receive all the glory. So he said, let us make man. And God created Adam and Eve in the garden. And lo and behold, the devil came again. The only two folks roaming the earth. And caused them to sin against God. To separate them from God. Now you thought again, God has lost it, right? There's no way out again. Oh my God. Daddy, how come they always rip you off at the back end? Well, don't feel pity for God. He doesn't want that. Because he's still in charge.
Oh, yes.
He said, you know what? When I made you woman, I made something in you. There's something in you that I own that the enemy cannot take from you. That is your womb.
Hallelujah.
Oh, my God. Help
Ooh,
me.
Glory to God. Yes, Lord.
That is your womb.
Mm-hmm.
Your womb belongs to God.
Mm-hmm.
So the devil can't touch that. It says your DNA, no matter how default it is, you have a womb. That reproductive part of your being is mine. I own it. So out of you comes something to crush the enemy.
Okay.
Out of you will come something to crush the enemy. That is why Your father might have been the worst, wicked, and evil person there is, yet you're a child of God.
Hallelujah.
Oh my God. I just solved your low self-esteem problem right
that's
now.
Right,
I just
that's
listen,
right.
I just did a therapy on you, a Holy Ghost center therapy right there. That's just deliverance on its own. It means your mother could be a witch, your father could be a wizard, but God can still make use of you and make you the greatest man and woman of God the world has ever known.
Hallelujah.
Oh my God. Is somebody hearing me this morning? Is somebody, because out of it comes something great. If you believe that, shout hallelujah this morning. Come and shout hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It means God can work in you. Out of you, something awesome comes out. Irregardless of what the enemy has done. Regardless of what the enemy is planning, regardless of what the enemy has conspired, regardless of what the enemy think they can do, you know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah.
Regardless of how the enemy is pushing things to cause you to default, God can still make good over your life. Bless his name.
Bless
Isn't he wonderful?
Oh, yes, he's awesome.
Isn't he excellent?
Wonderful
Father. He's a mighty God, right?
Mm-hmm.
He's a
oh, yes,
great
he
king.
Yes, he is.
Because God
Hallelujah.
Is still in charge. So Adam gave birth. Cain, Abel. Oh, but Cain killed Abel. You see, the enemy wants to kill again. And what he wants to say, no, no, no. We can't have a righteous man. Boy, can you see? This guy is worshiping God. God is still having a friend. I thought I've taken over this human race. How can there be a one that still pleases God? And the devil rose up and ruined Abel's life. Because the righteousness, the devil hates righteousness.
Mm-hmm.
So Cain killed Abel. And you thought God lost again, right? But no, no. Adam and Eve gave birth again. They began to give birth. Now understand the mystery here. Adam gave birth to Cain and Abel. And they were grown up men. And they thought they were done, right? No, no. God says, no, you're going to give me more. The womb belongs to me.
Mm.
The womb belongs to me.
Hallelujah.
You're going to give me a righteous seed. Whether you like it or not. Then came Seth. Out of Seth, then came Enoch. Oh, Enoch was holy. God says, whoa, whoa, whoa. I better take this out.
Mm.
And Enoch did not see death. Because the Bible says Enoch walked with God.
Mm-hmm.
And God says, no, the womb must still bring forth. The
yeah.
seed. I have spoken that the seed will come out from the womb. That will destroy the power of the enemy.
Mm.
And then comes Noah. Now, what am I trying to say to you? I'm trying to bring you to the awareness that Christianity has never, since creation or gospel or righteousness, has never ruled the earth. That's what I'm heading to. I'm taking a chronological journey of the history of man to prove to you that the earth, since Adam sinned, has been under the sway of demonic and satanic forces. And I'm trying to demonstrate to you that their powers are limited.
Mm-hmm.
Because the whole earth, since Adam, has been under the sway of Satan and darkness. Yet, the darkness has not been able to destroy God's people.
That's right.
Then it shows you something is very right here. You get this way?
Oh, yes.
It tells you that something is really right. Something is making sense. Because I don't want you to look at the news and you go, oh, Islamism is rising up, Hinduism is rising up, other religions are rising up. What is Christianity happening? Christianity is losing the ground. It's a lie. We've never won the whole earth. Never. Not even Jesus when he was on the world. He didn't preach to the Gentiles. There are more Christians on the face of the earth today than the history of the world since it started. There are more righteous men roaming the earth today than the whole universe since it was created. So we are not in the minority. In fact, the gospel has gained ground.
Hallelujah.
In fact, the gospel is gaining ground.
Glory
I say, in
God.
Fact, the gospel is gaining ground.
Yes, Lord.
If you doubt it, why not the Islamic nation open up their doors?
Mm.
Why not Saudi Arabia open their door and say, come and preach here,
that's
free,
right.
Freedom of worship. And I guarantee you that the church will explode.
Yes.
Why don't China open up their door and say, okay, come now, you can worship God. There's no more hindrance. And let's prove if this thing is a reality or not. It is not a hard thing. It can be easily verified. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, yes.
It is easily verifiable. Glory to God.
Glory to God.
Huh?
Hallelujah.
It's not complex, folks. It is easy, verifiable. You can verify the power of God.
Yes.
And the effect of this power in society. So go with me with the history as we proceed, as we progress in this journey. And as we progress, I want to read Psalm 2. I want you to understand certain things as we read the Bible and see what God is saying. Psalm 2. As folks go, oh, well, Pastor, you know, maybe. No. There's no maybe here. There's no maybe here. God has never failed. God has never lost any battle. God is not saying, oh, I can't help it. Can somebody help me, please? No. God is not in that mood. He has all the dominion. He has all the authority.
Yes.
He has all the power. Heaven and earth belongs to him.
Yes,
he is a God. He does not lie.
Oh, hallelujah.
And his wisdom is past finding out. Psalm 2. Why do the heathen rage and the people imagine a vain thing? The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us. Hold on. Who is in charge here? God is in charge. The Bible is saying, why are the ungodly, why are the wicked, why are the kingdoms of this world, the nations, the United Nations and all the nations, why, what are they trying to do? They want to be free from God. You see, righteousness is a yoke upon the universe. Let me repeat that. Righteousness is a yoke all over the universe, all over the earth. Man wants to get out of it. They are making laws to free themselves from it. They are trying to, and yet Christianity is not a pop, it's not the world's religion. Hello, hello. And but you see now that is the that righteousness, God has power. Dominion is still in God's hand.
That's right.
All right, let me take you back to the story, to the storyline, so you understand it. And there comes Noah. Oh, poor Noah. I mean, poor Noah in the spiritual sense. Do you know what it takes for God to tell you to do a thing, and it takes you 120 years to do that thing? Okay, all right, listen. I want you to listen to me. I didn't say 1 week. Whenever God gives you an assignment to do, and you are obedient to that assignment, death cannot take you out. Whenever God's word comes to you and God gives you an assignment to do it in this life, and there's a calling upon your life, and you are obedient to God, you have yielded your life to that, you're totally obedient to the things of God, to what God asks of you. Now listen carefully and hear me very well. Death cannot take you out. Cannot ruin you. Death will not be able to destroy you. Death cannot defeat you. Now, am I saying it very right? I want you to understand it. Whenever God has given you an assignment, something, and you are obedient to that calling, and you are obedient to that will of God, and you are obedient to what God is doing.
That's right.
You are obedient to what God has asked you to do. You're following hard after God.
That's right.
You're following after the will of God. You're following after the presence of God.
Mm.
You're following as you're following the mind of God.
Yes.
Death.
Mm.
Death.
Cannot. Mm-hmm.
Will not. Mm. Has no power.
Mm.
Has no dominion.
That's
has no ability to ruin you. You see, you will complete whatever assignment God has given to you. You will complete whatever assignment God has given to you.
Hallelujah.
I want you to hear me very well. You will complete whatever assignment God has called you to do. Because time and chance will wait for you to finish that thing. Because of the sovereignty of God's word over destiny. Now, Uncle Noah starts walking. First of all, God told him, I want you to build an ark. Well, this guy does not live by the seacoast. There's no river by him. God says, I want you to build an ark. I'm going to bring rain. And this man starts cutting. He didn't have electric saw. So he had to cut the trees and begin to build. It's a mystery, yeah? And when the righteous man, one man, was righteous, and the world was populated with people, with giants, with every kind of people, creation was booming. There were tongues, nationality. One man was found holy and righteous. And this man began to seek the will of God. And as he was building the ark, Bible says he endured mockery. He endured scourges and negative comment from people. Can you imagine what that man was going through? The torment. He was tormented. The Bible says in Peter, the righteous man was tormented for righteousness' sake. Building an ark. And when the act was completed, only 8 men were saved. Only 8. 8 people. Only 8 living souls. 8 men. 8. Noah, his wife. Noah's sons and their wives. Not their children. They didn't have children even. Maybe they had children. I don't know what. But I mean, only, you can imagine, only 8. Noah, his wife. His 3 sons and their wives. They were the only people saved.
You know, honey, that tells us that something, when God gives an assignment, you will face opposition.
That's right.
When people come to mock Noah,
that's right.
Then you will face challenges.
That's right.
Yeah, so sometimes the call of God, others might not understand it, but God that has called you and give you, God has given you the assignment to do.
Mm-hmm.
You have to know what God has given you to do. No matter the mocking,
hallelujah,
no matter the opposition or whatever they say, you keep it on.
Because you are going to face opposition.
That's right.
You are going to face difficulty from a godless society.
That's right.
Yet you must understand who is in charge. You must put that,
yes,
letter,
sir,
be settled in your spirit, man. All you ministers in the school of ministry this morning, you must understand it, that God is in charge.
That's right.
That God is in control. That God has dominion. That God is in charge.
That's right.
It's very important. Very, very important. Guess what happened? Guess what happened? Still. And God brought the flood. After that, everybody was dead. Apart from Noah and his family, right? Now, it's a mystery how sin entered the ark with them. Yeah. See, I'm trying to explain to you. I need to give you this foundational teaching before I proceed. You need to understand so that you don't become discouraged. And you say, well, nobody's serving God. The whole world is bad. And you begin to think you are in the minority. Yes, you're in the minority. But in another way, you are the majority. Because righteousness is still gagging society. Lawlessness has not really come out of the hell. Meaning, it's after rapture that God is going to pull off his hand of humanity. And then you're going to see what they call real wickedness. after the rapture of God's people. If you don't know what rapture is the taking away by the Holy Spirit of holy men and women out of this society. Then lawlessness, then the hand of God will be out of the earth for a period of time. So that there will be tribulation. Till then, God is still in charge. God is still in control. God is still in charge. He is always being in charge. We all, for the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. It is the Lord. The earth is the Lord's. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Everything in the whole earth belongs to God. God is still in charge. God still has control. God is still the one responsible. God is still the one moving. God is still the one doing great things. God is still the one bringing transformation.
Oh, yes.
God is still the one bringing changes. God is still the one. God is still the one at play. God has not failed. God has not changed. God cannot change. God will not fail. God cannot disappoint. God can. He is in control. And because he is in control, he has everything. Everything belongs to God. Everything belongs to God. God is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should repent or change his mind. God is still in control. He still has dominion. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
Bless the Lord, O my soul.
Oh, glory to God. He is in charge. Thank you, Lord.
I want you to tell yourself, God is still in charge.
God is still in charge.
Say it loud to yourself. God is still in charge.
God is still in charge.
No, I can't hear you. I can't hear you. Somebody say it. Shout it out loud.
God is still in charge.
Say, God is still in charge.
Praise the Lord.
All a conference muted.
Even in that situation in your life, you see, I'm trying to refresh your mind about the world because you are part of the world system. God doesn't want you to be in the system, but fortunately for us, we live in society. We live among people. We live among men that don't have the same viewpoints, the same belief system that you have. And yet, God is still in charge. God is still in, everything is under his control. God has not lost his power. God,
Oh, glory.
God has not lost his ability. Let me tell you, God has not lost his grace. God has not lost his mindset. God has not lost his capability. God has not lost his grace. God has not lost, I'll have it again, whatever. God is still in charge.
He's in charge.
You got to believe that. You need to know that. It must be clear to you that God has dominion. It has to be clear to you that God has not failed. You have to understand it. That God is sovereign. That God is sovereign. And because he is sovereign, he is still in charge. He is still in charge. He's an awesome God. He's a mighty God. He's a sovereign God. He cannot lie. He cannot disappoint. He cannot be put to shame. All right. So, the earth is destroyed. Guess what? Noah comes out of the ark. You thought it's going to be a holy nation, right? No. Because some of those animals that went in took sin nature with them in the ark as well. Hey, the snake was there, right? The serpent went in there. Don't forget. All kinds of snakes, they went there with him, right? Amen? So everybody comes out. Noah knew God, but his sons, his children never knew God. And guess what? Sin was introduced again. Oh boy, sin came in. The earth grew up again. The whole earth was in sin again. Then God called one man, Abraham. I want to prove to you that Christianity has never dominated the world stage. God called Abraham. Now, the whole earth was filled with people, every race, every color of humanity. Out of Noah family came the major races on the earth. There are three major races on the earth. Three major race or races. The Nubian nation, Egypt, or the black people, dark skin, the Caucasian people, and the Asianic people. The whole continent is divided in this group. And when they interbreed, intermarry, they create more diversion of the races. That's why you see, if you look at Asia, they have a special, beautiful look on their face. If you look at Africa, they have a special, beautiful look on their skin and their face, their eye structure, their skull. If you look at Europe, Caucasian nations, they're all the same. If you take a guy from England, take a guy from Russia, take a guy from Spain, they're all the same. Well, they intermarry and now it begins to spread. But the same race, Shem, Ham, and the other one. And out of that, God called Abraham, one man. Abraham was formerly an idol worshiper. And God says, all right, you're going to stop this. I want to prove myself to you. Who are you? I am. God never said, I'm the God of your father, Terran, Haran, or I'm the God of your father, Noah. No, no, no. God found a man. It is the first time now that God is coming to relate with a man again. God spoke Noah. Noah believed God. Noah walked with God. He obeyed God. But in Abraham's case, Noah acted by faith. But his faith was not a faith of personalizing God. In Abraham's case, it was totally different. The first time God is trying to establish the same relationship he had with Adam and Eve, of intimate fellowship again with a man. That was the first time since Adam. I don't know how many thousands of years that passed. And God came down, called this man, Abraham, come out. I want to make of you a new race on the earth. I want to make a people unto myself. I want to choose from creation now. I want to handpick a group of people that I can use to dominate the earth, that I can give the custodian of all my abilities to, that I can give my power, my ability, so that they can continue in my stead. And God called Abraham. You see, God knows everything.
That's right.
He's a smart God.
God.
The Bible says he's the only wise God, period. The enemy, the devil, is not as smart as God. He can't be as smart as God. The devil is not as smart as you either. If you are in Christ Jesus, you are too much smarter than the devil. So all he can do is to tempt you. Tempting you is to see if you're really smart. All the devil does is tempting you. Because if he tempts you, and that is where the foolishness in you comes out. Oh, someone's like, wow.
Yeah.
The devil is not smarter than a child of God. Because when you are born of God, you have the same wisdom of God. If you have, it says we have the spirit of Christ. We have the wisdom of God. You know more than the devil. You know more than the demons. So all he can do is to tempt you. The devil does not appear to you and say, I am devil. No, he knows you're not going to be afraid of him like that. Because you know too much more than him. You know how to handle him. So he has to hide to tempt you with your weaknesses.
And throw a bait
for you to. So you know what he did? So he came to God called Abraham. He says, leave your father. Leave your father's house. Well, Abraham did not want to leave. Abraham traveled. He took his father along with him. The Bible says the father died on the way. Because Abraham says, well, I'm the one taking care of him. I can't. Read your Bible very well. Abraham did not leave. Abraham left the father's place, but did not leave the father. He took Lot, took the father. They were traveling. So the father died in another place. When the father died, Abraham now moved from that place, from Haran, and continued to obey God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So you find Abraham walking with God. He obeyed God. He was justified by faith. God trusted him. And God says, out of you, I'm going to make a nation. Out of you, Abraham, I am going to make a people. Out of you, Abraham, I'm going to do something in the face of the world. Now the earth was hugely populated. There were all kinds of nations. There were the Nubian nation. Egypt has a king. The world has developed. There's mechanism. There's wisdom. They are building homes. They are building tools. They are building resources. They have discovered gold. I mean, the world was populated. Maybe there are millions there. Mm-hmm. And yet God says, out of you, I'm going to make something. Because what God is going to use is already in the world. Hallelujah, somebody.
Hallelujah.
What God is going to use is already in you. You are preserved for this generation.
Hallelujah.
Do you know why you were not born in the days of Adam? Why you did not live in the days of Abraham? It's not just because you're going to miss computer and technology, which that would be very sad. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Because Abraham never had a cell phone. Abraham never saw electricity, never rode a car. Oh my God. Can you see the better things that God has prepared for us?
That's right.
God help me. And of course, what man is going to invent, you know, better things are coming. Better inventions are coming. But God had a good plan for you. He wanted you to be alive this time. He created you so that you can partake in his glory. You can become part with God. You can help God achieve God's vision.
Hallelujah.
In that city where you are. You can help God move the kingdom. You can begin to invite people. Come to the prayer line in the morning. Oh, I can't join. Okay, join on Saturdays. If it's Saturday or Sunday, just come. Join in the evening. Well, you know, just you got to become an evangelist, a minister. Invite friends to come to your house. What you've recorded. Download it on the YouTube.
Hallelujah.
Put it on the video. Say, watch this guy. Say, that's my brother there. That's my brother, that's my dad, they are my family members. Say, well, but you are. Say, no, we are family, we are blood family. That's my brother. That's my sister there. This is what we want to do. We want to help people in this city. We want to help solve their problems. Say, how? Say, no. Spiritual problems, because that's the problem. If the spiritual problems are solved, the physical problem will adjust themselves accordingly. I keep on telling you about the vision. I said this last night. The vision God has given to us. Do you know why it's so unique? You and I. It is lately I discovered the reason God used us to pioneer this prayer teleconferencing technology in America. The past 7 years. I've come to see the vision. The vision is so beautiful that where you are, that city where you are, we're going to open a prayer city church. Oh, yes, we're coming to open it. Saturdays, that's when we meet. So on Sundays, people can go to their other religious institution. It's very good. But Saturdays, we're going to meet. It's going to be a time of fasting and praying. Saturdays in the morning, at that place, wherever God gives us in that city, we come together. We fast, we pray. Just the breakfast, you fast. By 12 o'clock, you break. You close the church. We fellowship, we eat. That is the entire move. We fellowship, we break bread. We fellowship, we pray. We fellowship in the word. Righteousness, holiness. A people harvesting and preserving, expecting the return of Christ anytime. But do you know that very soon, as you are ordained under Wawa ministry, give your ministry license, do you know what it is? It means basically in every city in America, we already have ministers ready to go. But that's amazing. Do you know what that means? In almost every major state in America, we have partners. And then once a while, you come in for the prayer city convocation. Amen. You
Amen.
Fly in, you stay in the prayer city hotel, you fellowship. If it's a week holiday, you come in. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Oh my God. It's like a pilgrim. You come once a year or twice a year or four times a year. It depends on you. Once every month, it's up to you. You just come with your group. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Woo, glory to God. The end of year administration, boy, that will be packed. Huh?
Thank you, Lord.
Just fly in with your group, or ride in with your group, and then we are waiting for the Lord. Folks, Jesus is coming again.
Oh, yes,
he don't get deceived now. He is coming again.
Yes, Lord.
But you are bearing fruit where you are because the kingdom of the earth belongs to our God.
Yes, Lord.
So God called Abraham. I'm still giving you the story so you are well grounded. God called Abraham. And out of Abraham, out of this one righteous man, God brought a seed, Isaac. And God dealt with Isaac. Abraham had other children. God was not interested in the other seeds. Keturah, the black lady Abraham married from Egypt, had 7 more children. Boy, I thought that guy was old. God help him. The guy had 7 more children. And he lived to see their children. He lived to see them. And he sent them away with gifts. And Isaac, from Isaac, we had Jacob. Not Esau. Esau left. God says, I don't know you. You're not my kind. Because it is the seed from the womb. There is something you carry that belongs to God.
Hallelujah.
There's something inside of you that belongs to God. Abraham was pregnant with Isaac. And then you're like, oh, Sarah, it doesn't matter. But you understand what I'm going to. It is that seed. That seed. And out of that one man, 12 tribes. And that 12 race, they're all God's children, right? They 120 of them went into Egypt. Take note of that figure. Within 400 years, they multiplied. They multiplied. I think it's another figure. 120 of them went into Egypt. They grew. They multiplied. 400 years later, boy, there were over 500,000 of them. It's amazing, eh? They expounded. God said, yes, I have found my people. Now it's time. Now it's the motion I've started. So, what are you talking about when you say, oh, Christians, we are... there has never been a time in the world. Egypt was a demonic country. They worshipped demon gods. They were worshipping Satan and all kinds of powers, astrology and voodoo and witchcraft. In fact, they learned witchcraft in Egypt. All the practices they learned was from Egypt. So what are you talking about? What are you saying? Oh, God has never lost anything. And that's the story of Israel. It is through the lineage of Israel that we have Jesus, that the gospel of Jesus, the gospel came upon the Gentiles, that we, who were once lost in sin, we who were once separated from the commonwealth of God, we that had no part of God, that God had no dealing with us. God didn't want to do anything with us, but in his plan, he was looking to us. But out of that tribe, Mary came out, and the seed was fulfilled. Jesus was born.
Hallelujah.
And when Jesus was born, Jesus took 12 men, began to prep them for the great work. And out of that 12 men, another man, Paul, joined them. In fact, it was Paul that God ordained and gave the gospel to the Gentiles. And that one man, Paul and Barnabas, went into the Greek nation, went into the Middle East. Out of that nation, today, you and I are witness. Out of that move of God in the East, went to Europe. From Europe, Christianity began to spread. After cultures, the Roman government, the Roman Empire, the world is growing, the Turkish Empire, the history Empire. I mean, Islam has been there before Christianity. The people have been, I mean, they've been following that direction. Hello? Islam is not older than Judaism. No. The Judaism has been there before Islamism. Hello? Because Muhammad is just a prophet around the corner. The history. Are you following me now? Jesus lived before Muhammad. Jesus lived thousands of years before Muhammad. Thousands of years. But Hey, they've been worshipping Hinduism before Christianity came. They're worshipping idols. They have their own religion. They were worshipping demonic gods. Egypt has never worshipped Christ. Egypt was worshipping demonic god. They have their own priests and the Midians, the Amalekite, the Moabite. Those are Hindu. Hinduism has been there right from Abraham time. They've been Hinduism. Hinduism is worshipping of idols. They've been worshipping all those deities for long, even before Christianity, before the gospel was preached. And boom, today, even in India, there are churches of God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
In China, there are churches of God. Even in Saudi Arabia, there are hidden churches. Hallelujah. So you see, the
Hallelujah.
gospel is spreading. Hallelujah. The kingdom of God is moving in God's timing, in
Glory.
God's space,
Yes,
in God's
Lord.
wisdom, in God's plan, in God's
Hallelujah.
strategy. Don't tell
Thank
me that the kingdom of
God.
God is failing. We're not failing. It's a lie.
Can't fail. Cannot fail.
We are not losing at all.
No, no
We've
way.
not lost any ground. We're gaining ground.
Gaining
All right.
ground.
So the gospel comes into the kingdom of the British Empire, and oh, they believe in God. All of a sudden, King James. All right. Hear me now. So you need to understand the history. I'm trying to give you a history this day. Because if I start teaching tomorrow about, I want to know where we are. So you will not say, well, the whole world is, we've not lost any ground. In fact, we are growing faster.
Yes,
The kingdom
Lord.
of God, glory to God,
Glory,
is
glory.
expanding.
Yes,
It says
Lord.
it shines like light in the darkness,
Thank you,
and the
Father.
darkness cannot hold, cannot comprehend. God has a master plan.
Thank you,
God
Lord.
is still in charge. Somebody say God is still in
God
charge.
is still in
Say God is
charge.
still in charge.
God is still in
Say
charge.
God is still in charge.
God is still in charge. Hallelujah.
This should give you confidence in the God you serve. Hey, in Africa, we're not Christians. 200 years ago, there were no Christians in Africa. In 1811, there was no church. There was no Christian. There was no Christianity. My grand-grandfather, great-great-great-great-grandfather, then, that is just 400 years. Four generation, I mean, four generation. My great-great-grandfather never knew the Bible, never heard about Jesus, never heard about God. But he knew about God. Because even though they were witches and wizards, they could know that the God exists. Because in the spirit realm, God always visits them.
Oh, yes.
God communicate with them. They knew God, but they don't know. They never knew how to worship God. They were not allowed to worship God. They didn't get the VIP invitation. So bad for my great grandfather, because he was not invited to worship God. God did not invite him. God had no use for him yet, but God had a use for his seed. Because I was still in his loins. Is somebody hearing me? You were still in
Hallelujah.
your great-great-grandfather's loins while they existed, worshiping what they were worshiping. You were still in that loins because God had a plan for your life. I hope you know you didn't fall from the tree. They were carrying you in their DNA, in their sperm. You were in their loins, in that ovary, in that egg. So they gave birth to your great-grandfather, and your grandfather gave birth to your father. Hey! And so a guy called Mungo Park, a British missionary, went to Africa. Hello, died there. I mean, they're trying to bring Christianity. And in the last 100 years, Christianity began to come in. Missionaries began to come in. The missionaries that came from here in America, those forefathers that abolished slavery, who began to preach the gospel in the 1800s, got revival. So in the early 1900s, that was the last century. We are in the 2000 now. Can you imagine that? That was 1900, looks so far, right? In the early 1900, the gospel began to penetrate all across the world. Missionaries from America. America was not a Christian nation. Don't deceive yourself. America has never been a Christian nation. The Christianity in America, it wasn't everybody in America was a Christian. It's a lie. People, we are still Christians in America. We have more believers now than before.
Hallelujah.
Only the Africans in America alone, God help you. And all of a sudden, we're excited about God. We're excited about Jesus. Why? Our forefathers were not privileged like these forefathers here who knew God, but their children did not understand the power of God. Yet God in his wisdom knew a time is going to come that America will be lukewarm and cold towards Christianity. So he sent you here. He allowed you to come here. He brought you. Know why you are here? He planned it so that you would be in America at this time as this, so that the fire of life, the fire of revival will not go off. He planned it. He's so wise. I tell you, God is so wise. Before they stop giving visas, before they start playing games, when they never knew why people want to come to America, you bought your ticket. Somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hey, my God. My, somebody shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Shout hallelujah. God is smart.
Oh, he is.
You thought you were coming to school, right? Duh. What school? You finished school long time ago. Why didn't you go back? No, God didn't want you to go back.
Oh, yeah.
God had a plan. So God messed the back home for you so you can go back.
Mm-hmm.
Because if the home was too good, you would rush back. Mm-hmm. God says, no, I need you here.
That's right.
I need you here. I have a plan.
Definitely.
And you go, I want to go home. Then you go. 6 months, you are back again. Well, it's too hard. Yes, God makes it hard over you there because God wants you here. God wants you established here because the earth is the Lord and righteousness exalts a nation. You say, what about those? No, back home, God has reserves. There's always a reserve. God has people good enough to handle the situation there.
That's right.
So when you were 18, when you were 15, you were restless. All your folks were happy to be with their parents, mom and dad. But no, you were, all of a sudden you were tired of being mom and dad's pet. You wanted to leave. And they didn't understand why. Oh, but they sent you out. And boy, you came here. It was rough. It was hard. But now, you know the rules. Now, you know the system. Now, you can move yourself from one state and go to another state. It will not be hard for you. You can easily adjust because, hey, you know the system very well. And God says, now, let's launch the plan. Now, this is the plan. For this purpose, I created you. For this purpose, I made you. For this purpose, I brought you here. For this purpose, oh boy, who can pray in the morning? They can't pray in the morning. There are great churches in America, great men and women of God, big churches, big pastors, that they can organize a prayer line. It will be a blessing, but they can't because they are not used to it. They don't even know how to do it. Well, it will be easy. Some of them have 7,000 members, 20,000 members. 20, can you imagine if all of a sudden all the churches in America begin to wake up and get a teleconferencing prayer line and they just come in the morning and we begin to pray? Oh, but it's going to happen though.
Hallelujah.
God is going to begin to touch their heart because sooner or later they're going to be hearing, wow, in prayer city, how did they do it? How did they start? Huh? Oh, we can do much. And for it, they can even do more better. And guess what? Revival, God is still going to take the glory.
Hallelujah. Oh, yes.
There's coming a time that's why I said it's going to be once a week we congregate Saturday morning so that we see each other's face in every city where you are. You know what I'm saying? Because there's going to be a time in the next 1 year from now, the next 16 months, technology is going to be so cheap and easy. Folks, we're going to have our own application. You just click one button. The whole world sees us. Right now, I'm doing Ustream. On the Ustream, anybody with internet on the face of the earth that has good can join and watch live.
That's
and that day is coming whereby internet will be so cheap in all over the earth and they will just wake up. Boom. Prayer TV. The whole world is watching.
That's right.
Millions watching.
Hallelujah.
Millions watching. Just a few years from now, you're going to be seeing it happen. What am I saying? God has a plan for you.
Yes,
you fit in God's plan. I just told you the history. How God saw you in Noah, how God saw you in Abraham, how God saw you in the missionaries, Martin Luther in Germany, that brought Reformation.
Hallelujah. Because he's a God of predestination. He knows the end from the beginning.
He knows the end from the beginning. He is a God of predestination. He knew all things. There's nothing that's going to surprise God about you. You are God's instrument.
Hallelujah.
You, yes, he said, but pastor, I can't preach like you. I didn't say you should preach like me. Just open your mind, let the Holy Ghost use you. You'll be better than me.
Hallelujah.
That is if I let you. Anyway, amen.
Amen.
You know, the more you know, the more I want to know more. So I'm not going to fold my hands. But God has a gifting in you. There's a specific anointing. There's a grace upon your life. You have a grace. You have a grace. You can be like me. You can copy. Paul says, copy me. Copy what is good. You can copy me.
Oh, yes.
As I copy Christ.
That's
why. Well, Pastor William, you know, my city, huh? It's rough, yeah. No, it's not rough. That's why you are there. Are you seeing the blueprint? Psalm 2.
Oh, yeah.
The kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed. It didn't say it's against his people, because it is the anointing that breaks the yoke.
Hallelujah.
You are under that anointed.
Yes,
you are
Lord.
Part of the anointed.
Yes, glory
you are
God.
Part of God's plan.
Yes, Lord.
For this
thank
millennium.
You, Lord. Woo!
All of a sudden, with the Gentiles that were not called with Abraham, but God said it. See, God does not do anything outside of his word. He said, out of you, the whole nations of the earth will be blessed.
That's right.
He told Abraham, before he even had Isaac, out of you, the whole nations of the earth will be blessed. And the blessing came in the form of gospel. You see, wherever the gospel has gone, in any society where the good news of Jesus has been preached, they produce scientists.
Hallelujah.
They produce engineers.
That's right.
You know why America took over the world, although it was the youngest nation? And all of a sudden, it took over the world. America brought the airplane. No other nation developed the airplane. America was the first country to bring forth an airplane. America was the first country to bring forth a car. America was the first country to bring a cell phone. America was the first country to bring a microwave. There is no invention on the face of the earth since God created the man that has come from any other country than America.
Hallelujah.
But I call America children born out of righteousness.
Yes,
the
Lord.
Aeroplane you fly, well, two pastors' children, the Wright brothers. Their father is a Baptist preacher, a pastor. It was his son that brought aeroplane that says man can fly.
Yes, Lord. Glory to God.
Bill Gates brought you software. The mother was a very religious Christian. Oh, you want me to count? How many can I count for you? You are part of God's end time plan.
Yes,
and
Lord.
God has greater things. Jeremiah 29, he says, for I know the plans that I have for you, saith the Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Listen, don't believe any lie. God has good plans for you.
Hallelujah.
God has great plans for your life.
Hallelujah.
God has somebody begin to thank God.
You,
say,
Lord.
Father, I give you praise
you,
that
Lord.
Something good is going to come out of my
Lord.
Life. Somebody begin to pray with me this morning.
You, Lord,
something
Lord,
good.
Something good
is going to come out of my life.
Come out of my life, oh God. I worship you. I give you all the praise. I give you the glory, oh God, for the plans you have, oh God.
Good stuff.
They are good plans.
Listen, you are precious to God.
Hallelujah.
Don't worry about the mistakes you've made. It's okay. It's good. God knew you were going to make those mistakes.
That's right.
Oh, don't worry about the marriages you've lost. Oh, well, no, it's good. God knew you were going to be divorced.
It's all in the package.
It's all in the package, and God knew you're going to get a better husband.
That's right.
But Pastor, I'm 60 years old. Well, if you don't want to marry, you can be Mother Teresa. It's good for you. Amen. At least you can pray more. But God, there's no restraining order on your anointing. Pastor, you know, I didn't know. God knew what you were. There's nothing in you that is surprised to God.
Thank you,
God. Duh. Man, do you see what he did? I never. No. You have been bought with a price.
Yes, Lord.
It was the
you,
blood
Lord,
of Jesus.
You
are uniquely gifted.
Hallelujah.
Pastor, I don't have ability. No, it's a lie. Discover it. That's why we are here to help you. My assignment is to help you fulfill God's assignment. Therefore, I'm doing God's assignment because it's one assignment. You are a peculiar people.
Yes, Lord.
You are a chosen generation.
My God.
You were handpicked for this generation. God chose you. It's not an accident. You were chosen because you were not listening. So you had so many problems to bring you to the prayer line. Isn't God smart? Because the only way God could get your attention is making problems come to you. And whenever you want to run away, the problems will come again, so you can stick. So, hey, you are in for a lifetime.
Glory.
And because you are very smart, you now know that you don't need to go out from the will of God.
That's right. That God is the only way out.
Because you don't want to be learned. You don't want to be like the animal that cannot learn. That has to be whipped and put on yoke. No, no, no. You are much smarter. Mm-hmm. Because why? God has made you smart.
Glory.
And then you know that everything around you, your resources is not yours. You are a steward of God's resources. You are using the resources for your family benefit, for your benefit, and for the kingdom of God benefit, so you don't waste your resources. You know that you belong to God.
Yes, Lord.
That you belong to God.
Thank you, Lord.
Therefore, no weapon that is formed against you shall prosper.
Amen.
Every tongue that rises against you in judgment, you condemn.
Thank you, Lord.
Say after me, God is still in charge.
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 God is still in charge.